good morning to one and all present here. On behalf of the Physics Department and the Physics Alumni Society, I invite the gathering for the third Professor K.A.M. Karunakaran Endowment Lecture. God, a creator, has stored within our minds and personalities great potential, strength, and ability. Prayer helps tap and develop these powers. So we shall begin with a prayer song, followed by Pray for the College by Professor Carolyn Michael, and Pray for the Alumni by Professor D. Selvakumari. I request the gathering to kindly rise.
Praise my soul, the King of heaven. To his feet thy tribute bring. Ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Evermore his praises sing. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him, praise the ever.
Let us pray for the college. O thou who in days past didst put it into the hearts of good men to found this college, for the imparting of sound learning, the building of character, and the spread of spiritual truth and knowledge of thyself, bless our college and schools. May love, unity, and brotherhood be learned here. May industry, uprightness, and courage grow here. And from this place, may there be sent forth continually a stream of men and women who shall serve thee faithfully in thy world. Amen.
Pray for the alumni. O God, of whose gift alone it cometh that thy faithful people do unto thee true and faithful service, we pray thee to follow with thy blessing those students who have gone out from amongst us to serve in the wider arena of life outside these college walls. Strengthen them to meet victoriously all temptation. Enable them for the faithful performance of their life work, and may they ever without fear of man follow steadfastly where duty, right, and honor lead. Amen.
I request the dignitaries to kindly occupy the dais. May now invite a former professor and president of the Physics Alumni Society, Dr. N. Lakshmi Narayan, to deliver the welcome address.
Very good morning to all the students, our distinguished speaker, Dr. Sundar. Thanks to Professor Adar and Professor Kumar Sethian for having come today. Dr. Sanjay Asirvadam, the faculty members and staff of the Physics Department for their organization of this important event. Thank you. I was just going through the MCC web page and the page for the Alumni Association, and I realized that the Physics Alumni Society, which started in 2010, was along similar lines. In fact, it seems to be as if it was drafted after looking at our meeting in 2010. It goes like this. The Alumni Association of the college is the oldest in this country and the richest in the sense that the list of alumni from MCC were the leaders of India, sort of, starting from President Radhakrishnan, the first president of India. The website goes on like this. The college is proud of having the oldest alumni association in India. It was founded in 1891, 124 years ago, on the initiative of a group of former students with the object of organizing an annual reunion. The day of the meeting was called the Christian College Day, and the association the College Day Association. The first meeting was attended by about 350 members, and the proceedings lasted a whole day. In order to encourage the association, Dr. William Miller endowed a sum of rupees 5,000 in 1891 to meet the expenses of the annual meeting. Our alumni society started along similar lines. We had a contribution of about 60,000 from two or three people, 2010. We had the first meeting and it's been going on regularly. The alumni of physics department are quite here. Dr. Sundar is quite familiar with them, many of them. Dr. Rajaramana was his boss. Dr. G. Venkataraman was his boss. He is familiar with Dr. E.C. Sudarshan, Professor Lakshmanan, Indumati, so many people. I would just like to tell him that the present set of alumni, the youngsters, are also doing great. And the next decade, I think you'll find a lot of our MCCNs getting in the news in the scientific fields. And one of them recent was, I don't know if you're aware of that, the ALICE experiment in CERN. Adhila, around 1 lakh ICs called MANAS was supplied by India. And the designers of that chip was Swapan Sen and Sandeep Sarkar. Sandeep Sarkar was our student, my student, Dr. Samuel Asirvan's classmate. So, physics alumni are always and will be doing it. And these are the future greats who are coming up. They are there. Something about the formation. The alumni decided and agreed wholeheartedly to start the series of KMK endowment lectures. This was envisaged as a value addition to the department's already established prestige with the national academic and scientific bodies. For the students, a chance to hear about the latest advances in science and technology from a most distinguished speaker, one of whom is here, and also personally interact with them. A little about Professor K.M. Karunakaran. K.M. Karunakaran graduated with B.Sc. Honours and served on the faculty from 1950 to 1987. In between, he completed his PhD with honors from the University of Kansas. And Dr. Sundar was very near the University of Missouri in Kansas City, Kansas State. So, a lot of familiarities. In fact, we also realized this morning that the first speaker, Dr. Thyagarajan, and Dr. Sundar are childhood friends. So, they know each other for a long time. It's a very nice news for us. MCC faculty and staff obviously must have been some of the best. And my teachers I know were the best with their commitment. But then there always will be the best amongst peers. Professor KMK was one such, and a legion of students would vouch for his style of teaching. I was one of his lucky students and still remember his style and clarity of presentation. He demystified the mysteries of quantum mechanics and made us all so comfortable with it. He was a great teacher. Something about our speaker for today. I saw him in 1976 when I was an embassy student when we went to Kalpakkam. Half a dome was complete, one full dome was over, one and a half domes were over. He was a scientist there, scientific officer there, and so we have been in touch with each other for the past 40 years. He's a brilliant person, a very simple person, for all the power he has wielded. Dr. Sundar, he will be introduced formally. I'll just give you some glimpses. He's a senior professor at HBNI. HBNI is Homi Bhabha National Institute. A fellow of all the three science academies. That's no small business. And he's also a member of the Asia Pacific Academy of Materials, being a material scientist. He's currently a J.C. Bose Fellow of the Government of India with the Material Research Group at IGCAR. That is after his retirement as the director. He still is there. He was on the editorial board of many journals, and right now he's the associate editor of Bulletin of Material Science. He is there in all these scientific bodies, UGC, DAE, DST, whatever you name. And I suppose everywhere he'll be coming across our MCC alumni. More importantly, he was the project coordinator for the following two DAE projects. I don't want to name them, it'll be said to you soon. The budget amount of these projects is in the range of 35 crores. To put this in perspective, let me tell you this. MCC is now going for the college with potential for excellence. NCC should be automatically given that, but anyway, now we are applying for it and we'll be getting it. And if we get that, we will get a financial assistance of 1.5 crores. Just imagine the magnitude of money he was handling in such a beautiful place. I think all the students who are physics students here should in one time or the other go and visit IGCA in some context. It's a great monument of Indian science. And it's, as I was telling, it's a nuclear park. You have five different types of reactors there. And he grew with it. And unlike some of us who teach instrumentation without really handling all the instruments, he's a person who's going to tell you about the instruments which he has handled. And he has the most sophisticated instrument at his call anytime. He wants a nuclear reactor, he can get it anytime. So we have such a distinguished person. Dr. Sundar, for accepting our invitation. It is a pleasurable privilege to have you with us. Thank you.
May I now invite the head of the Department of Physics, Dr. Samuel Asirvadam, to introduce the chief guest of the day to us.
Good morning. A very good morning to all of you. Actually, since Dr. Nilan has introduced partly the speaker, I'll be doing part of the welcoming as well. Actually, you know, Miss, we have students from other colleges, specifically from the Meenakshi College, and their staff members, Dr. Manju and another ma'am has come. So I welcome all the students from other colleges, and of course all of our students, and a special welcome to Dr. Professor Arthur and Dr. Kumar Satyan sir. It's a pleasure to introduce the speaker of the day to you. Dr. C.S. Sundar is currently a J.C. Bose National Fellow and a Senior Professor, Homi Bhabha National Institute with the Material Science Group, IGCAR Kalpakkam, and Visiting Professor, Material Science Program, IIT Kanpur. He had his education at University of Delhi. He had his B.Sc. Honours and M.Sc. Physics from University of Delhi. And then he, after finishing his M.Sc., he joined the BARC, Bark Training School, and then IGCAR Kalpakkam in the year 1974 as a scientific officer. Then, during that time, he finished his PhD from the University of Madras, and then he went on to do his postdoctoral at University of Missouri, for which he was a visiting professor later. And later in the year 2019 to 14, he was a director of the Material Science Group, IGCAR Kalpakkam. Dr. Sundar has been with the Material Science Division, IGCAR, since 1974. After graduating from the 17th batch of Bark Training School, he has established active research programs in the area of positron annihilation spectroscopy and has been involved in the studies of defects and phase transitions of novel superconducting materials. He currently heads the Material Science Group with a comprehensive research program comprising of basic research on frontline areas of material science, the use of ion beams and computer simulations to simulate neutron-induced radiation damage and development and applications of squid sensors. As Dr. Nilan sir pointed out, he was the project coordinator for two DAE projects during the 11th plan period, 2007 to 12. Of course, we won't be having plan periods now onwards, I feel. These costed totally 35 crores, only for that period. So I don't know, the total amount of cost of several projects he has handled should be more than this. Dr. Sundar has guided 6 PhD students and has been involved in several academic and educational programs at IGCAR, which includes organization and delivery of lectures for scholars in physics and chemistry, and conducting annual summer school summer training program for physics and chemistry students since 1995. He has been facilitating summer projects for students. So all these he has been doing as a scientific officer. Dr. Sundar is a senior professor at HBNI, a fellow of all the three Academy of Sciences, Indian Academy of Sciences, National Academy of Sciences, Indian National Science Academy, that is a FNASC, FASC, and FNA. You should know what these are. right now he is the J.C. Bose Fellow of the Government of India. He is a recipient of MRSI Medal in 1994, MRSI Superconductivity and Materials Research Prize in 2007, and Tamil Nadu Science and Technology Award for Physical Sciences, and quite a lot of other things, achievements. Dr. Sundar serves on several important national scientific committees, such as the Scientific Advisory Committee, UGC, DAE, CSIR, Research Council of the National Physical Laboratory, New Delhi, Nanoscience Advisory Group of the Department of Science and Technology, member of the councils of various constituent units of Department of Atomic Energy, such as IGCAR, RRCAT, and VECC. And he is a member of the Board of Studies in the Physics at HBNI. So, I don't know how many of you know what is an FNA, what it is to be a fellow of the National Academy of Sciences. That is kind of highest achievement for any scientist in India, to be a fellow of such, it's a very august body. So I hope and expect several students of us to achieve that pinnacle of achievement. So on behalf of the Department of Physics, we are very happy to have Professor Sundar as our speaker for this third Professor KMK Endowment Lecture. So with this note, I hand over the proceedings to, okay, we'll continue with the proceedings. Thank you.
On behalf of the Department of Physics, I request Dr. Samuel Asirwadam to present a memento to our chief guest. Without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Sundar. Over to Dr. Sundar.
Professor Lakshmi Narayanan, Professor Sam Asirwadam, Professor Arthur, Professor Kumar, dear students, faculty members of the MCC, I'm really happy to be participating in this, to be delivering this Professor K.M. Karunakaran Endowment Lecture. Morning when I was in your head of the department's room, we were talking about our association, and it looked, though I am not from MCC, very quickly it became like I'm one of the family members of this very affable group of people. Of course, my own first boss, Dr. G. Venkatraman, was from the Madras Christian College, and several of our professional colleagues who have done well, whom I respect and whom I would like to emulate, like Professor R. Srinivasan, they are all from this college. So you are all members of a very, very distinguished college. And as Professor Lakshmi Narayanan was saying, he expects all of you, or most of you, to reach that great heights of doing good things in physics. It's also very nice that the Physics Alumni Association is having these lectures in memory of one of its great teachers. It's very nice. It's very nice that we pay respect to somebody who has taught us so well. What I am going to talk to you is about states of matter, both traditional and exotic. I am going to talk to you about, can I have the previous slide? Yeah. When I started, am I audible at the back? Yes? Okay, fine. Yeah. I have tried to pitch this lecture for the MSc or BSc students. So if by chance you are not understanding some of it, please do stop. I was told that I have 1 hour this thing. I have prepared a lot of slides, so I can stop at any time. And so, but if you do not appreciate some part of it, please do stop. And of course, after the discussion, after the lecture also, I am available for discussion. What I am going to talk to you about is about the evolution of the subject called condensed matter physics. Okay? This is a subject, like Professor Lakshmi Narayan was mentioning, we have been in this field for nearly 4 decades, and it is a subject which has essentially grown in front of our eyes. as we as professionals. We see so many things happening. So while I was preparing for this lecture, I just really wanted to take a stock of why is it that things develop this way? What is it that drives the field? Okay. Can I have the next slide? This is one slide of our interest over various periods of time. Okay. Science is after all what scientists do. What have been people doing over a period of time? See, in the 50s, if you were talking to people in the 1950s, they were interested in what was called as the electron theory of metals. How does one understand the properties of metals in terms of the way the behavior of electrons? Over some time later, people got interested in semiconductors, superconductors, disordered materials, and these are all, you would have seen this picture of the fullerene or a buckyball. People got interested in 1980s. Now today people are interested in graphene. There is a subject of quasi-crystals. In the 80s, people were interested in high temperature superconductors. Much later, people are interested in Bose-Einstein condensation. Today, people are interested in a field called topological insulator, and so on and so forth. Now, these, many of you as young students may not have heard of many of these topics. Okay, it is quite possible. You do not know what is a topological insulator. You may know what is a superconductor. It is possible you know you have seen this fullerene, and so on. But my purpose in this lecture is to take you through, is there something common? These are all several new materials, all right. But I am not going to talk about materials, new materials as such. I am going to talk to you about new states of matter. Okay, what are the different states of matter which have been new as we progressed in our, as we did research. The next slide. This is actually a one slide of a summary of, you people study Kittel or still study Kittel? Okay. This is one slide of whatever is there in various chapters of Kittel. The traditional solid state physics is about study of crystalline solids, right? It's about study of solids. So if you go through the chapters, you will have a chapter on X-ray diffraction. Last year, you had a talk of Professor Bhai Gautam talking on X-ray diffraction. Then you have a chapter on where the atoms are located. We celebrated 100 years of crystallography, the Bragg's work, which led to understanding of the structure or using X-rays to get the idea of where the atoms are located. Then you have a chapter on how the atoms vibrate. Okay, these are the positional atoms, how do they vibrate, what are the various modes of vibration, then how the electrons, how does the resistivity behave, or how does the electrons behave in the as it moves in a crystalline solid, then you are told about valence band, conduction band, and so on and so forth. And then there is a chapter on magnetism, each atom has a spin, the electron has a spin, how do these spins orient themselves, and how does different forms of magnetism come, and so on and so forth. So basically, the two cornerstones of solid state physics. See, solid state physics is about, or the subject of solid state physics started developing in the early days of quantum mechanics. You start with quantum mechanics, you start with hydrogen atom problem, then go to helium atom, and so on. They are all about one electron system, two electron system, and so on. A solid is an assemblage of an Avogadro number of particles. There are 10 to the power of 23 electrons which are there. Okay, so the early development of the subject was how does one apply quantum mechanics to this assemblage, large assemblage of particles. That was that this thing. So if you see, most of the earlier pioneers in the field would be the people who have helped to develop the subject of quantum mechanics itself. So basically, solid state physics is about quantum mechanics and statistical mechanics. What makes it possible to make some progress is the fact that many of the properties of a solid, though we say it is 10 to the power of 23 electrons and so on, it can be understood in terms of a single electron picture. It is as if the single electron is moving. It's not, you don't have to consider the vast number of electrons. The second thing which makes solid state physics tractable is the fact that the solids that we are dealing with are crystalline solids. Crystalline means they are periodic. There is a single motif, there is a building block. So you do not have to consider the whole solid. you consider a small part of it, maybe a small part like this, and start doing the problem. Okay. So the two important things about solid state, or what we call as a traditional solid state physics, which is what is covered in Kittel, is about crystalline solids and about doing a one electron problem. Okay. Over a period of time, of course, how long can you study sodium chloride? How long can you study potassium bromide? And so on. The subject has developed. Okay. The general change, if you see, one of the changes has been that people have started, instead of having an atom as a building block, you can have a complex motif as a building block. Okay? You can have a longer chain of this thing which are arranged periodically, and so on and so forth. The second, so from that you go on to, or you can artificially tailor the material. You don't have to do experiments with God-given material. You can have materials which you can construct on your own and study properties. So that has been one trend of one change. The second type of change which has happened is not dealing with just a single electron. Properties where the behavior of correlated behavior of electrons become important. Am I being clear? Okay, that is, electron correlations become important. One of the important ways where the electron correlations are important is the subject of magnetism itself. Magnetism is about, you know, magnetism is arrangement of spins, right? The spins can be, when the spins are parallel, you say it's a ferromagnet. When the spins are anti-parallel, you say it is anti-ferromagnet, and so on, right? So, at this level itself, you can see it is a correlated behavior. That what is the underlying reason for a magnetism? That if the spins are parallel, if that energy state is lower, it comes because at the heart of the magnetism is the Pauli's exclusion principle. Right? It is a Pauli's exclusion principle which says that if the quantum numbers are same, one electron cannot sit on the top of the other electron. Right? So it keeps, if the two electrons have the same spin, it keeps the two electrons far apart. And when the two electrons are far apart, the Coulomb interaction is, energy is lower. Okay? So the magnetism arises because of the way the electrons with spins behave. It's like a dancing of the spins. Right? So that is a correlated behavior. Magnetism can never be explained within the way you can explain why something is a semiconductor. You can explain with the one electron picture, the way the electrons move in a periodic lattice. But there is no way you can explain how magnetism arises unless you talk about the correlated behavior or the ordered behavior of the electrons. Okay? So the subject has also grown beyond talking about just a single electron picture. Next slide. I have given the title as states of matter, so let's retract a bit. What do we really, as young students, you all know, when we talk of states of matter, we know a gas is a state of matter, a liquid is a state of matter, a solid state of matter. Maybe some people will say plasma is a state of matter, right? Now, do you agree magnet is a different state of matter or no? Is magnetism a state of matter? Yes or no? We agree solid is a state of matter. Is magnetism a state of matter? Yes or no? No? Why do you say magnetism is not? Okay, a metal a different state of matter compared to an insulator? I think magnetism, I will try to argue why magnetism is a different state of matter. We have an intuitive feeling of what is a state of matter. For example, if I say, is water and olive oil different states of matter? No. Yes or no? We say no. Water and oil are same state of matter. They are liquid. But is aluminum and iron different state of matter? No. I would say yes. Aluminum is non-magnetic. Iron is magnetism. magnetic. So there is some property. What I would say is, whenever a new state of matter comes, there is some emergent property. There is some property which the other one doesn't have. Iron has a property which aluminum doesn't have. Iron is a magnet. Okay? So we say magnetism is a different state of matter. We would like to understand why. Why it's a different state of matter. That's what the subject of condensed matter physics tries to address. One of the problems. We say superconductor is a different state of matter. Liquid crystals are different state of matter. So let's go on to defining, fine, if we are not very clear about, because the title is states of matter traditional to exotic. So I have to come to exotic states of matter. So let's get the ground background with respect to what we call as traditional states of matter. Certainly you understand. See, when we are talking about states of matter, you talked about the phase diagram, right? There is a phase diagram of water. There is a liquid phase, there is a solid phase, there is a gas phase, you raise the temperature, the solid becomes a liquid, and so on. So we have an intuitive feeling of what defines a state. We will quantify what does it mean to define a state of matter. See, I told you in the last one of the previous slides, I showed you people in research have discovered so many materials. But I am going to address on what are the different states of matter which people have discovered. Because that is the part which I would like to convey in this lecture. Okay, so let's next slide, please. We will now address this part on how do we define what is a state of matter. We know a state of matter is something, there is an attribute, there is some characteristic, there is some property, fine. But how do we define what is the state of iron, or what is the difference in the state of aluminum? Okay, the state of matter. I have shown a picture of ice. Okay, and this is a picture of, let's say, water. Molecules of water, and what do you see in the two pictures? The picture of ice it's a crystalline form of solid, right? Ice is crystalline. So atoms are sitting in an ordered arrangement. They are sitting in a definite position. Ice is a hexagonal crystal. In water, the atoms are moving randomly. It's a disordered position. Now the question I will ask is, which one is more symmetric?
Ice.
Yes, most people would answer ice is more symmetric. Unfortunately, it is water which is more symmetric. You rotate the water, picture which I have shown, you rotate it any way, it will look the same. Whereas ice will look the same, what the picture which I have shown, only if I rotate by certain angles. Right? Or in other words, what we will say is, water has both a translational order and a rotational order. It does this. Whereas this one has only certain order, right? So the point I am trying to drive home with this is, which is said here, water has complete rotational and translational symmetry. It's actually this phase which is more symmetric. This phase is actually less symmetric. Okay? When you saw in the previous phase diagram, water goes to ice, it actually undergoes, it breaks a symmetry. Okay? So the phase is actually quantitative. We said what defines a phase, because I'm going to talk about various states of matter. So what defines a state of matter is something called an order parameter. Okay? There is an order. If the order builds or order disappears, okay, that is a quantitative. The man who made this formal was a Russian scientist called Landau. Landau developed this theory of quantifying. He developed the theory of phase transition. See, when you want to develop theory, you have to have, science is about developing a correct language. Okay, it's about developing a language. Otherwise, we will just be groping. So this part of transition, he understood in terms of an order parameter. And a phase transition involves a broken symmetry, some symmetry. So two key concepts which he developed was a face gets defined by an ornament. For example, in the case of magnetism we were talking about, development of magnetism is defined by development of a magnetic moment, right? The material has a magnetic moment. So a magnetic moment defines an order parameter. So in the paramagnet, for example, this was a magnet, in the paramagnet the spins are all rotating, are all in all directions. Whereas in a ferromagnet, the spins are facing parallel to each other, like this. Okay? So the magnetic moment here defines order parameter. This we have to keep in mind. Because when I'm going to talk about the new states of matter, we will talk about those systems where we will have difficulty in defining what is an order parameter. We will come to that. Next slide, please. So let's ask the other question. Why is there so much diversity in states? Not even new matter. So much diversity. After all, there are only so many, all the atoms, the matter is made of electrons, the interactions are between electrons. So after all, the building blocks of matter are the same electrons. How is it that we end up with so many variety? That something becomes a magnet, something becomes a non-magnet, something is a semiconductor, something is a metal, and so on and so forth. Basically, the difference states of matter arise because of only two crucial things. One is the way they are packed or the way they are arranged, which may lead to a new state of matter, or the way they interact among each other. Okay, the way they interact is, for example, that the way they interact is what distinguishes an aluminum from iron. The way they are arranged is more or less the same. Okay, so the two crucial things are about packing. We said there are obviously a solid has 10 to the power of 23 electrons, but they are made of the same electrons. There is nothing which distinguishes electrons in aluminum from electrons in iron. But they arrange themselves differently, or their interactions are differently, and you have so much different states of matter which are actually exploited for different applications. Okay. Now, the different types of packing. Now, in this lecture, I want to talk more to you about the electronic states of matter, which is far more the different states of matter that arise because of the interactions. But let's first dispose of the different states of matter which arise because of packing. Okay. We will talk about glasses, quasi crystals, and liquid crystals, and so on very quickly. Next slide. Okay. You know, most crystalline solids are made up of packing of spheres. You talked about FCC structure, BCC structure, and so on, or HCP structure, and so on. And it's just packing of spheres. It helps you to build a picture of the crystalline order. And that has a certain packing fraction. If the packing was not regular, if it was disordered, you have a lower packing fraction. This is like a jelly beans is put here, the packing fraction is lower. And this is actually what distinguishes a quartz crystal from glass. It's the same silicon dioxide is the building motif. One is disordered, one is ordered. Okay, when it is very ordered, then you get the quartz. When it is not so properly ordered or disordered, you get the glassy form of quartz. And this happens to be less dense as compared to this. You can clearly see from the picture also, the density is less. And that's why to make quartz, you have to do high pressure. Quartz is synthesized, whether in nature or in the laboratory, if you have to synthesize quartz, you have to do high pressure experiment. It is not necessary just to melt it. If you melt it, you will not get this form. You have to melt and also apply pressure so that this dense phase gets formed. Okay, a simple argument of why any experiment which makes quartz crystal will also do experiments in the process of growing. They will also have to apply pressure apart from temperature so that the atoms start moving. And if you just cool it, you will get only this. You will get the glassy form, amorphous form, because it is slightly having a lower density. So if I have to make them arrange in a crystalline form. I have to keep them molten and I also apply pressure so that they get into this configuration. Okay. Now, why do I say glass is a different form of matter, phase, different phase of matter? Now, my whole theme of lecture is about not talking about the details of the material, but why do I say glass is a different phase? This silica is different from this silica. Chemistry is same. They are both made up of SiO2. But this is a different phase, and this is a different phase, or this is a different state of matter compared to this. Now that comes from a way, variety of, the way this behaves. If you raise the temperature, the way the viscosity of a crystal changes, the way the viscosity of the glass changes is different. The way the specific heat changes with temperature is different. I will not go into the details, but both by from the way of dynamics and by thermodynamics, it is very different. So it's a different, glass is a different. Actually, many of the experts will say, understanding the glass. Glass is one of the oldest subjects. People have done so many things, including all sorts of fine work with glass is done. But from the point of view of science, it is one of the least understood subject. It's still an active area of research. Next slide, please. The other thing, last Karnakaran lecture was on crystallography. And you know, when you are taught crystallography, or when you are taught solid state physics, you say it's about periodic arrangement of atoms. And you are also told that that periodicity or translational periodicity does not allow for some rotational order, right? It, for example, you cannot tile a plane with pentagons, right? So if the system has to have a translational order, that is, if you have to pack this floor with tiles, you certainly cannot pack it with pentagons. You will get gaps. That is because a five-fold symmetry is inconsistent with translation. Okay? So it is like a well-known thing. And in 1984, Scheckman did this experiment of quenching aluminum manganese. It's a very, this thing. Actually, and he found sharp diffraction peaks. Okay? Sharp diffraction peak is associated with crystalline order, right? When you do X-ray diffraction, you get a sharp Laue peak. You say, my sample is highly, perfectly crystalline. Otherwise, I will get some diffuse rings and so on, right? He got sharp peaks. But notice the sharp peaks. The sharp peaks have a five-fold symmetry. How is it that you are getting such sharp peaks, which is what we are told? Sharp peaks means crystalline order, but that crystalline order has a five-fold peak symmetry. And this was something which shook the subject of crystallography. And in fact, today, it made change the definition of what is a crystal. A crystal is something which has a sharp diffraction peak. It does not make a statement that it should not have this symmetry. Okay? What is the type of... This has a different order. We are still talking about packing only. It has a different order. This order is, it has a long-range orientational order, but it does not have a translational order. It's a different form of packing. And imagine, this was discovered only in 1984. Crystallography is such an old subject. Mineralogy is such an old subject. People have studied these materials. You would think there is nothing new to be discovered. And some experiment by one of these, this thing. It's a very standard experiment also. Most people, if you have listened to the talks on, by some of the electron microscopists, most people when they see this picture, they would have thrown it. Maybe I have made a mistake. It's not right. But this man had the courage. In fact, he had the courage to fight another great scientist called Linus Pauling, who said this is all trash. For 20 years he fought with him. And in 2008, or 2010, he got the Nobel Prize. Scheckman got a Nobel Prize for discovering a new phase of matter from his electron diffraction. Okay, these are called quasi-crystalline phases of matter. Next. Of course, you have the liquid crystal, which is there in all the display watches and so on. These are all long molecules, and then it can arrange in variety of phase. You can have an isotropic liquid, a pneumatic liquid, smectic and so on. I will not go into the detail, but in terms of packing, these long molecules, instead of having spherical balls, which were, you had a packing, here you have a direction, and this has a different forms. By different ways of packing, you get different states or different phases of matter. Okay, and the different phases are described in terms of an order parameter. In this case, the order parameter is the way the long axis of that rugby-shaped ball looks like. Okay, that is the order parameter. That defines, for example, in an isotropic liquid, this is zero. That is, it can look in any direction. And as it directs itself, you get different phases. Now let me go to the next slide. Now we will, as I told you, I will talk about the phases of matter which comes from electrons. We are not talking about the way the atoms are arranged, which itself leads to different phases. And in your solid state physics, you are taught the subject when you start, the independent electron. That is, we told you that we will talk about how different interactions among the different phases of matter or different states of matter come from two roots, one by the way they are arranged, the acting, or the way they interact. Okay. Now let's first start with no interaction. They are free, independent electrons. Howsoever ridiculous this assumption looks, after all, you know the electrons are having a very strong Coulomb interaction. Or as Landau himself said, you cannot repeal Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law exists. Okay? But the electrons try to behave as if Coulomb's law doesn't exist. And many of the properties which we do under what looks like a ridiculous assumption, as if the electrons are independent, works. And it forms a basis of our understanding. Okay? We will try to see the first part, the independent electron approximation. If a teacher is teaching independent electron approximation, any student has a right to put up his hand, why are you talking about this nonsense? You can say, you are justified. After all, the electrons are interacting with Coulomb interaction. Why are you saying they are non-interacting? Okay, we will see how scientists try to understand how they behave as if they are non-interacting. Okay, we will see that part. Anyway, this is the, so my lecture is about trying to talk about the conceptual developments in the field. The things which worried the scientists. Something may work, but the scientists are also interested. Why did it work? Okay, you will see that. Okay. The assumption is basically the electrons are not attached to anything. They are just, it's like a gas of electrons with Coulomb parts switched off. So use the same kinetic theory of gases, the same formula you are using. Okay. And a very famous one is the Drude picture of the electrons are moving freely and once in a while they hit and they scatter, which leads to resistance, and he developed a formula for resistivity which works for most people. But it could not explain, if you know the story, it could not explain the fact that the electronic specific heat, the specific heat due to electron, if the particles were independent, you know from your classical kinetic theory of gases that each particle, the specific heat will have a contribution. It will be 3 by 2 kT will be the specific heat, okay? But experimentally, when people measured, it was not to be so. The specific heat is much lower, okay? Or what we say as the specific heat is much below what was known from the Dulong and Petit's law, right? When you measure at low temperature, the specific heat is much lower. And this was remedied by, again, the people saying, we will still consider electrons are free, electrons not interacting with each other by charge, but we will take the statistics of the electrons. Electrons, after all, are Fermi particles, so they obey Fermi statistics, and just take the Fermi-Dirac statistics and go ahead. And this helps to explain the specific heat. And this is what people like Pauli did, to explain the specific heat of the specific heat is linear in temperature. If people had measured the specific heat of electrons at low temperature, or metal at low temperature, and it is linear. And that comes from the fact that basically the concept that because the electrons obey Fermi statistics, they are like packing of marbles, they cannot all condense and go into the ground state, there will be a packing, so there is something called a Fermi level, or there is a Fermi surface. So electrons only close to the Fermi surface can be excited by temperature, right? This is an argument. So they are all packed like in a ball. As you raise the temperature, the electrons only near the surface will be excited, and that fraction will be kT by EF, and you give an energy kT, and then you take the derivative, you will get a linear specific heat. Okay? It explains the magnetic susceptibility, it explains cohesive energy, and so on. These were all progress in the 1930s, of trying to explain the properties of metals. I told you the very first slide, up to 50s people were interested in applying quantum mechanics, surely applying quantum mechanics to explain properties of metal. For example, why does a metal have a linear specific heat? This was explained by just taking into account the electron, the fact that the electrons are obey Fermi-Dirac statistics. That's all. Next slide. The other development is that the electrons are moving in, after all, you know, crystalline solid has a periodic arrangement of atoms. So it is like as if the electrons are moving in a gallery, okay? It's like a, through minute arcades, the electrons, they are not like particles, they are like waves. And this, and because it's like electrons moving in waves, only certain modes are allowed. Only certain modes are allowed, and this what leads to what is called as a Bloch theorem, or the electronic energy levels are only certain states energy levels are allowed. Okay, this is all what is taught to you in what is today called as a band structure paradigm. It has been so useful. You are told, anybody you ask a question in any interview, please tell me what is a metal, the student will immediately draw this semiconductor, what is an insulator, there is a conduction band, there is a valence band, and so on. This explains why something is a metal, it will explain why something is an insulator, it explains, the Bloch theory explains why resistivity varies with temperature the way it does for some materials. It actually explains, very interestingly, before this Bloch theory came, you know, I will talk about you all heard about Hall effect and so on. So originally people used to get the Hall coefficient negative, but there were some experiments where the Hall coefficient were positive. So people didn't know why the Hall coefficient was positive. It was Rudolf Piles who explained this within the framework of the band theory. And this is the same picture as what you will see in the Dirac theory and so on. There exists a concept of holes, okay? And this is now for the man who first proposed it, that I can invoke another particle. I can invoke that there is something called an effectively positive thing which is moving around to explain the Hall effect. Okay, that led to the development of concept of holes, which today we use without even thinking. For the person who did that to explain the Hall effect data, today we know if you have a semiconductor, you dope it with boron, holes are produced, you dope it with phosphorus, electrons are produced, electron light carriers are produced, and so on and so forth. Okay, these were all the significant development, and in fact the whole of development of semiconductors with silicon, with so many things done, people being able to precisely make, control the doping to get the property, get the high mobility, all this, the whole of semiconductor physics is just based on this slide. This is the development of solid state physics. And I'm telling you, if we are reaping so much benefit out of what was done in the 50s and so on, imagine what the new states of matter will do, how many different things will come out. And that's what I want to convey to you. Okay, so this is your traditional, the most traditional solid state physics, band theory of solids, okay, which has worked so well for silicon. People have developed the methods of solving all this and so on. You cannot, Bell Laboratories did excellently good work. Okay, now we'll go to the next slide. Yeah, this is the part. The another conceptual development is, we said, no, how is it the electrons, free electron picture works? As I told you, this was a great man Landau, cannot repeat Coulomb's law. This was a very big conceptual development. We are talking about, as I told you, is when we talk about electrons, when we talk about electrons in aluminum, we are talking about 10 to the power of 23 electrons which are moving out. Somehow they behave as if they are free. This concept was understood by people like Landau and Pines and so on. It is basically by dividing the excitations into two types of excitation. There is a collective mode. See, when you have, and there is a single particle mode. This is, see, you have, imagine this room full of electrons, they're moving. They actually separate out. The way they behave separates out to two. It's a very, very, very nice concept. The way they behave, it separates into two. One is a what is called as a collective mode. Collective mode means it's like a density oscillation, which is called a plasma oscillation in the case of metal. Okay? And in that, there is also in that sea of plasma oscillation, there is also something which behaves like a free electron moving around, or a dressed electron, at best a dressed electron, or a marginally free electron. Okay? So if you look at, this was a very great conceptual development. Because otherwise we can keep on saying, it's so difficult, I have just been able to solve the helium problem, how can I do this, such a big thing. It is, the people made this, that by dividing this excitation into what is called as, essentially it separates the two. There is a plasmon mode and there is a free electron, quasi-particle mode. And this is part of it. And of course there are some things which still doesn't go beyond that. What happens if the interactions are very strong? And this we call as correlated metals and correlated electrons. We will see, I mean, if I have time, I will talk about it. Next. Now I'll talk about some special states of matter. Magnetism, we did, though some people didn't agree, magnetism is a different state of matter. Superconductivity is a different state of matter. Okay. Now we'll see, we'll discuss something on superconductivity. Of course, this is a subject. Superconductivity was discovered in 1911 by this grand old man, Kamerlingh Ohms. He liquefied helium in 1908. He studied, I have the slide for that. And he discovered superconductivity in mercury in 1911. In 2011, as I keep saying, we are living in fortunate times. We are celebrating 100 years of all great things. Okay, like we celebrate 100 years of Lavoie's work. 2011, we celebrated 100 years of Kamerlingh Ohms's discovery of superconductivity. This is one field. Again, not so much as crystallography, which has got 35 Nobel Prizes. This has got 7 Nobel Prizes. Now, as a student of science, you know, what is so great in superconductivity that it is worth 7 Nobel Prizes? What is so great in superconductivity that it is worth 7 Nobel Prizes? Okay. What is it that, okay, Kamerlingh Ohms discovered superconductivity, he got a Nobel Prize, fine. What is it that people kept on doing that it got so many Nobel Prizes? We'll talk about that story of what is exciting about superconductivity even after 100 years. Okay. That is something you should ask. Okay. It's fine. Next. This is a picture of Kamerlingh Ohms. And he was the first man to liquefy helium. There was a competition with Dewar. He won the competition and he liquefied first. And he did this experiment on how does the resistance vary as a function of temperature. And you know, he talked about the free electron picture and so on. So at that time, the prevalent theory, this is 1911. Lord Kelvin said, the resistance should increase as you lower the temperature. After all, the electrons are moving, as I lower the temperature, it becomes difficult. Electrons will freeze out and resistance. Then the Dewar said, no, scattering will decrease and resistance should decrease. Okay. And Matthiessen said the resistance should become flat. Kamerlingh Ohms did the experiment and he found the fourth behavior, resistance went to zero. Okay. So here was, somebody said it should go up, somebody said it should become flat, somebody said it should go gradually. What Kamerlingh Ohms did was, did the experiment, and that's the power of an experiment. Okay, did the experiment and did this and found it to be zero. And he got within 2 years, it is a Nobel Prize. And how do you know it's zero resistance? There were many skeptics even those days. How do you know it is zero resistance? Maybe your meter cannot measure. Maybe it is a resistance which is below the measurement limit of this thing. And you must, if you know, read the story, Kamerlingh Ohms spent the next 3 years showing or proving the skeptics that it is zero resistance by doing this experiment of setting the current in a loop and seeing the current, this thing. If you have the patience, please do it. People kept looking at this for 2 years, 3 years. Now we believe, Baba, we believe resistance is zero. The current is not decaying. One got the Nobel Prize. Okay, next. There is another important part of aspect of superconductivity. It's not just zero resistance. The other one is what is called as a Meissner effect, okay, which was discovered in 1933. And this is where, you know, in a normal material, if you apply a magnetic field, the magnetic field permeates through the medium. Okay. In a superconductor, next. the magnetic field is expelled. It is a, it's a diamagnet. And not only that, this part of it, next part of it, I think there is something, right? This is the fact that it does not allow the magnetic field is cannot be explained. This state that it will expel the magnetic field will come whether you start with this and lower the temperature. See, after all, it's a material of infinite conductivity. So there cannot be any change of flux, right, according to Lenz's law. So if I take this also, if I lower the temperature, the field will get expelled. So it's a thermodynamic property. Whether I cool it first and apply magnetic field, or I apply magnetic field and cool it, either way, it will expel the magnetic field. A superconductor is a perfect diamagnet, and it's actually a far more important property in characterizing what is a superconductor, and helps to understand what is a superconductor than going with the data that resistance is zero, right? Now let's see what was the next step. Next, he say, Kamerling once said resistance goes to zero, or he showed resistance zero. On Meissner effect says that magnetic field is expelled. Now, how do you know a superconductivity? See, if you have an observation of resistance going to zero, you can have very many explanations of why, when you are, especially if you don't have an explanation of why the resistance becomes zero. This was the experiment of Kiesem in 1932, which showed that a superconducting transition, or a material becomes from normal to superconducting, it's a phase transition. How do you know something is a phase transition? After all, mercury he cooled up to some state, it was behaving like a normal metal with the normal characteristics of resistance variation with temperature, and below, spectacularly below some temperature, its resistance went to zero. This experiment, when they did specific heat, after all, you know, specific heat is a thermodynamic property. Okay, you measure the specific heat of this material, then the specific heat of a normal material goes like this. The specific heat of the superconductor jumps. So whenever a specific heat changes, then you know, you do experiments on DTA and so on, right? A specific heat jumps, that means it's a thermodynamic transition. It's a very important conceptual development. It's not some electrical property is changing. It's not as if the electrical property of superconducting state is different from the electrical property of the normal state. It's thermodynamically different. That's otherwise you will not get a signal in specific heat, right? You get a jump in the specific heat. It shows it's a phase transition. Now you will ask the question, phase transition in what, phase transitions of what, and so on, right? That's the next question. Next. So that's the question. So we say, okay, we know it's superconductivity, we can be educated enough to say superconductivity is a phase transition. Now then the next question, phase transition to what? What is ordering? We have also seen that Landau said whenever there is a phase transition, something is ordering. So there is an order parameter which is developing. Okay, what is the order parameter? So these are the conceptual questions. Next. And a man who made a very great help, very great contribution in understanding this was London, Fritz London. And in fact, if you see this, this is a really a great understanding of, he developed the model, he actually developed a phenomenological model of superconductivity, which was based on what is the same as the, you know, by that time superfluidity in helium was also discovered. There is something called a two fluid model of superfluidity. There is a normal fluid and there is a superfluid and so on. So based on developing phenomenological model, he could understand the superconductor also has a property that the magnetic field, while it expels, or it doesn't allow the magnetic field inside, it allows the magnetic field to a certain depth, which is called the scheme, penetration depth. Okay? So London's theory had an explanation for the penetration depth. But more importantly, in fact, London was trying to understand the electrodynamic properties of superconductors. Okay, that was his work. But more importantly, London's work led to another great thing. See, here is a superconducting ring. And the this is the same as what Kamerling once did. He set the current in this ring, which is not going to decay because it has a zero resistance. The current is just flowing round and round the loop. Okay. But the magnetic field cannot penetrate, or the current actually flows only on the skin of the loop. Okay. This has a very important part. The supercurrent flows only in the penetration length, and inside it is zero. So in the inside, the current J is equal to zero, and you know the momentum is P minus EA by C. What you want to say is essentially V is zero, or P is EA by C. So this is as if the whole thing actually is the current is flowing in a loop of the superconductor, and if you just do this P dot dl is NH. Okay, it is as if it is the same. Or what was London's very good contribution was that a superconductor is a macroscopically coherent quantum state. Okay, just try to assimilate this. It's a very, very profound state. It is just like, imagine, this quantization condition is the same quantization as for the Bohr orbital, right? The electrons are moving out, and out of that you get the quantization condition. You have here a macroscopic, you take a superconductor, which is like a niobium wire, bend it round like this. When the current flows, okay, it is the same quantization rules are applied. So a superconductor, whatever it is transiting, it is undergoing a phase transition, but the state it reaches is a quantum state. Okay, that's a very important thing, and that came from London's work of identifying it undergoes a phase transition. It's not a classic. The state it has gone in, it has gone into, and it's a very profound thing. After all, we say a niobium wire, I mean today a CERN runs with kilograms of niobium wire. So, or we have, he was talking about Manas chip contribution to CERN and so on. So after all, superconducting magnets run the Large Hadron Collider. So it's all kilometers of wire. So I think it should strike anybody that if I say that kilometers of wire is in a single quantum state, I think for everybody, the whole thing is described by a single wave function. That's what London said. And that is the spectacular nature of his contribution. Of course, it's very sad that he is one person who never got Nobel Prize. Among the several people who got, he should have got a Nobel Prize for his single contribution of identifying a superconductor. Quantum coherent state. And we see how many things came out of it. Okay, next. Just previous slide. See, this, the quantum flux, the unit of flux is such a small quantity. It is 10 minus 7 gauss per centimeter square. That is, each one is a flux quantum. So when you run a magnet, you go to any MRI magnet, which runs at 4 Tesla. Okay, this is the magnet. So the magnet of 4 Tesla is precise to the extent of, that is, if you take 4 Tesla, it is like there are 10 to the power of 15 flux quantum are going through that. So that is the type. See, that is the quantum position you are getting in all this matter. Okay, next one. This I will not discuss further. Okay, maybe I have to go. Next. There was, while the, maybe previously, these people, Landau and Ginzburg, took the phenomenological theory further in defining the order parameter and so on. But maybe I will go to the next slide. There was also the one thing about, now we will, one development which took place in this thing. Superconductivity was discovered in 1911. It took 40 years to get an understanding of what this transition is all about. Many brilliant minds were involved. One experiment which changed our understanding was the experiment, this was 50, this was after Second World War. Isotopes were available. Okay, but prior to that people didn't have isotopes and so on. And somebody did the experiment, same experiment of whatever Kamerlingh did, except that he did with isotopes of 203, 202, 200, 2.6 and so on. Okay, this was possible because thanks to the wartime effort, isotopes, and somebody did the measurement of transition temperature versus for various isotopes of mercury. Again, these are all phenomenal things that somebody does experiments on superconductivity of in various isotopes of mercury. It would not occur to anybody. Okay, that, in other words, even to put it in a very this thing, that TC depends on the number of neutrons. After all, isotopes are different on based on number of neutrons. Who would think TC is a solid state property? And number of neutrons is a property of the nucleus. And that, it depends on this thing, and that depends on the mass, square root of m, which immediately told people that somehow lattice vibrations were important. Like TC goes as 1 over square root of m, and any even the dumb-witted fellow will say, okay, somehow in that the heart of superconductivity is the vibrations of atoms are involved. After all, the frequencies goes as 1 over root m, right? Omega is under root k by m. So that was the involvement of the phonons. The vibrations are somehow involved in transferring the normal state of metal into some this exotic state which we call a superconductivity, which also happens to be a quantum state. Okay? And somehow the vibrations are playing their crucial role. That comes from this experiment for isotopes. Next. And it was left to these people of Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer, who developed in 1957 what is called as a pairing theory of how the electrons pair. The electrons at the two opposite edges of the Fermi surface. I have been showing this yellow colored copper Fermi surface. And the electrons at two opposite sides, they pair, and that pairing of these electrons, though they are positively charged, they are same charge, negatively charged, it comes because of the involvement of the phonons. This is the common example they will give. It's like a mattress trying to attract to this thing, and so or the, when the one of the charge moves, it disturbs it, and the other charge, that is this charge moves, it pulls all the positive charge closer, and this charge coming much slightly behind time sees this disturbed lattice and gets attracted. So that is effective attraction, and brilliant thing was to develop a model for this pair and develop a theory for it. Next slide. And people will say this is a paper which they wrote in 1957, and this was considered a jewel in the crown. It is one of the 2D force of, it explained all properties of superconductivity. Specifically, critical field, current density, Meissner effect, penetration. In fact, these are all the section headings of the various sections of the paper. 35-page paper, which explained all that has to be said about superconductivity, was done. And it took 1911 to 1957, a lot of theory, which, you know, there were several phenomenological theories for the next one. I will not, a few things. Just talking about superconductivity. Essentially, because there are a lot of young children, this in a normal metal, you have the filled electrons and the empty states. You have, there is a Fermi level which lies here. In a superconductor, there is a gap which opens up between the filled and the unfilled. And it is this gap which you can call as the order parameter. It is the opening of the gap which is responsible for the superconductivity. And it was Giavar who did. If you have a normal metal, and you have a superconductor, you can have a tunneling. That is, if the current which flows from the normal to a superconductor, which is called a tunneling, will depend on the applied bias, and you will get a tunneling behavior like this. If you apply a voltage, then you can have more tunneling current and so on. And this helped to map the gap, experimentally get information on the superconducting gap. And Giavar got a Nobel Prize in 1973 for his work. Next one. Most spectacular is, of course, the fact that this Giavar's work is on tunneling of electrons between a normal metal and a superconductor. It is still the electron. Now, I told you the superconductor is described by a single wave function, because if it is true, then there will be very, very nice features. This was shown actually by Josephson, which is what is called as a Josephson tunneling. You can have tunneling of the superconducting pair between one superconductor and another superconductor. Okay, and this is basically, if you have a superconductor and connect an insulator between the two, even in the absence of any applied voltage, there will be a current which will flow. Okay. And this is a very spectacular feature which illustrates the macroscopic coherence, quantum coherence, which exists in a superconductor. Okay, And this is similar to what you have. I mean, this is a nice picture of seeing the Josephson effect. You have, this is, let's say, the yellow dots are the superconducting, and you break the superconductor. You see, okay? This is like, he draws an analogy between photons and electrons. So in this case, you have something like a Fraunhofer diffraction. If you have two slits, then, or two barriers in the superconducting, then you have like a Young's double slit experiment. So an output of a Josephson device will be an oscillatory field depending on the magnetic field that you apply. And this forms the basis of one of the most sensitive detectors of magnetic field. A superconducting ring. A ring which is made up of a superconducting material, two superconducting material, which are broken by one small insulating piece. And this is because this part of the ring has a macroscopic phase coherence, this part of it has another coherence, and there is a jumping, or there is a current which flows depending on the phase difference between the two wave function. And that phase difference can be changed by applying a magnetic field. And so you have a sensor which is the world's most sensitive, because it detects a single flux quantum. A single flux quantum will change the phase. And we in Kalpakam use this type of detectors for detecting the magnetic field which comes from the beating of a heart. Okay, this is a very small field. Or for the more importantly, a magnetic field, a non-invasive detection of a magnetic field, what is called as a squid-based magnetoencephalography or a squid-based magnetocardiography. So heart beats, there is an electric field which is generated. There is also an associated magnetic field. So if you put this sensor in front of your chest, you can detect the beat. I have not brought all those slides. Similarly, you put a helmet consisting of squid-based sensors, and then based on a stimulus, suppose a light is hit on my eyes, which part of the brain fires? That can be picked up by this signal. Okay. So these are sensors, these are applications. Actually, one thing about condensed matter physics and material science is, as we develop, there are so many applications which we come. We talked about Large Hadron, while people were struggling with understanding the theory. Today you have magnets, which run the world's biggest accelerator. You have everywhere, hospital has your MRI machines. These are developments of superconductivity. You have the sensors, which are the most sensitive sensors, which are based on this. Many people as scientists know, these are something which has happened in the 70s. And I was a part of a research team and so on. So I am saying this part we have to keep in mind, that this, the applications come without our knowing also. Okay, this is next. Of course, I will the work for, maybe I think I should. This is, okay, next slide. The people have been working on increasing the transition temperature and so on. And the field changed completely. Can you go the next? Dramatically. With the discovery of a new form of superconductor. The maximum TC they could get was only 23K. This was 1986. These people did this experiment, Bednaus and Muller, and they got a transition temperature of 35 Kelvin in a material which was a black powder. It was not a metal. It was looking like a black powder. You can see in their dish they are showing. This is just a black powder, which was superconducting, with a transition temperature much beyond what people could have got, people had tried got getting earlier. And this has completely changed the face of condensed matter physics. The next slide is, this is a work by Paul Chu, who got a 92 Kelvin, and the race was on to increasing the transition temperature to higher and higher. Now, since I am talking about the different states of matter, I should mention, a superconductor is a different state of matter compared to a normal metal, that you, I am sure you will agree. Now, the considerable work which is going on into, because this type of superconductors cannot be explained in the conventional way of explaining the superconductivity. It cannot be explained within the BCS framework of this thing. And today's work, my work in the last 25 years, intense work, is trying to show that this class of superconductors, the high what are called as high temperature superconductors, they belong to a different class of, the different state of matter. In fact, it is a state of matter which cannot be described within the Landau's prescription of considering in terms of quasi particle. It will actually change our understanding of looking at, see, again I'm saying, it is like, it's after all the same electrons. When do they arrange themselves and you have completely a different state? We agree. A normal metal is a completely different compared to a superconducting state. This superconductor, these high temperature superconductor, are a different class. They are a different state of matter. And this state of matter, the description of this state of matter is one of the most intensely pursued research today. Okay? And can I go further? I will not detail this thing. I should go into the last part. Why is it different state? Because here the description of the electrons in the moving in the antiferromagnetic background itself is very different. Okay, next, last. This is a quantum phase transition. I am not going to. Can you?
I think I should.
I will just last stop with talking about topological insulator. Okay, that's what I want to do. Next. Please go ahead. These are all our work and I'm not going to. That's previous. See, in the last 5-6 years, there is a considerable range in a new field which is called a topological insulator. How many of you heard this subject? Heard? No? Okay. Now, so this is a good point. We know about normal insulator. Okay? This is taken from one of the other things. I mean, after all, we agree, superconductor is a new state of matter, no doubt, right? And it's a quantum state of matter. Right? Now I'll tell you about a new state of matter, which has been the rage the last few years, 6 years. It's a new state of quantum matter, and it is a matter which will help electrons to propagate with zero resistance and so on. So I think as physics community, we should be aware of what is this? What is this new material? Okay, let's go to the next slide. Next. This is like, it will make you go from a traffic jam to a super highway. Next. Okay, that's a type of a new material which is coming up. Something which will make the electrons flow, not like we talked about Drude model where electrons are constantly bumping into each other and so on. This is a new state of matter, a new organization of electrons. Okay, if you know what it is. So what are these topological insulators? How are they different from ordinary insulator? And you will also briefly tell, how did scientists come to discover this new state of material? Right? Okay. Next. Let's start with the ordinary insulator picture. We have seen by now, you are all experts, you know, this is a valence band. This is a conduction band. Right? This much you know about electrons in solid. And if there are some defects, then let's say phosphorus in silicon, let's say it's silicon, then it will have some levels here. If it is boron, it will have some levels here. That's fine. Now, we also know that the valence band is made up of antisymmetric wave function, right? Because it is, valence band is a lower energy state. Electrons want to keep away from it. An anti-symmetric wave function keeps electrons away compared to a symmetric wave function where the bonding, so it's an anti-symmetric orbitals will lead to this valence band. Symmetric orbitals lead to conduction band. Okay. This is one additional information. If you didn't know, I'll tell you. Next. Now you have this, you know, electrons also have something called a spin-orbit interaction, right? Spin-orbit electrons are described that they have spin, and that they can have spin-orbit interaction is described by the Dirac's picture of the electron. Now, a spin-orbit interaction is what? What is the interaction which was used to explain the atomic spectra and so on? It's the interaction between the way the electrons move and the way its spin is arranged, right? It is an interaction between the direction of the motion of electron and the way the spin of the electron is pointing. Okay? They are coupled. Or if it is very strong, that means they are coupled. Okay? Today, see, after electronics, people are talking about spintronics, how to manipulate electronics with spins. Okay, this is, I'm
trying to talk in that. So what happens is, if the spin-orbit interaction is taken into account, you don't take normally spin-orbit, not clear? Okay. If the spin-orbit interaction is not taken into account, then you have this picture. If you take the spin-orbit interaction, then you can have a situation where the what is called as the valence band for some range, for some momentum direction, it can become higher energy state, and this what is blue, shown here in blue, can become higher energy state for some direction. This is E versus K diagram. This is a band diagram, and something which is a conduction band can get. So you clearly see that there is a twisting of the band. You can see that, right? In this case, this was the conduction band, this was the valence band, this was the conduction band. If you take spin-orbit interaction into account, in some situation, you can have the bands are twisted. Okay, that much you can see from this picture. Okay. Now, there is another, what we call as, when you say the bands are twisted, is the same, that's the same, this band is inverted. That is the inverted band. Now, if you look at the inverted band case, in this case, the backscattering is forbidden. Now, I will have to explain. What do you mean by backscattering of electron? Backscattering is electron from K is flipped and comes as a electron. See, after the electrons are moving on a Fermi surface. And when you say backscattering, what was a K vector becomes a minus K vector. Right? Now, in this configuration, if the electron of K becomes a minus K, that is, this is E versus K. So, if an electron with a momentum K becomes electron with minus K, associated, it has also to flip the spin. Right? So, when it changes direction, it is also forced, because of the spin-orbit interaction being strong, if the electron, when it reverses, after all, scattering is what? Scattering means electron comes back. If it comes back, if it also has to change its spin, then that becomes impossible. You cannot change the spin, direction of the spin, unless the scatterer happens to be a magnetic scatterer. Okay? So, scattering is forbidden, in that sense. So, the electrons at the Fermi surface travel unimpeded. This point is, see, I wanted to say it was by its topological issue. Here the Fermi surface of the electrons at the surface is like a normal circle, or it's like a, this is a Möbius strip. And sure enough, when you see a Möbius strip, you see topology is involved, right? The Fermi surface, which is showed as a sphere, has now a very different shape. Has a twisted, has a topology involved in it. The bands have a topology involved in it. And because the bands have a topology involved in it, certain scatterings are not allowed. You know, in this picture, if the electron goes like this, when it makes a round trip, it will, if suppose the electron with this spin goes up, it will pick up a phase of 2 pi. Here, it has to make two trips in a Möbius strip. It has to make twice before it comes back to the same direction. Right? So when it makes one trip, it actually comes with an opposite phase, which is same as saying it has a destructive interference. And that is not allowed. Now, this is a simple band picture. It's nothing, it's no great this thing. But the fact people realized this only in 2006, that this twisting of band can lead to. But of course it came, next slide, I'm not going to, this came in the context of graphene, which has a double twist. Okay, next. And this is also another way of seeing this. See, when you say it's a topological insulator, it is because of the twisting, it is as if the, okay. What is important about this is the bands intersect at one point. And the intersecting point, can I have the previous slide? Yeah, that's fine. This point is protected by time reversal symmetry. This is what is called as a Cramer's doublet. Now it is, see, the why topology comes in is, there is no way, if this state is there, I can easily take it and shrink it back to, it's like two rubber bands which are this thing, which are intersecting. And there is a theorem which says that this dot which is there at the center cannot be removed. Okay, that's a theorem. So there is no way this states which are moving around on the electrons of the surface are protected by topology. And that is a very interesting. That topology is involved in getting a new state of matter. Okay? Or in other words, let me put in another way because I will stop with this. See, most of the time, this understanding came from studies on integral quantum Hall effect and so on, which is in itself this very, very interesting field where the fact that topology of the wave function is involved. And today it is all very hot, very, very interesting areas of work because people are interested in doing quantum computation or topologically fault resistant quantum computation. So if you have a state which is topologically protected, then you have a state, you can do wonderful things. So this field is driven by people, actually most people who are working in the field are high energy physicists and people who have a very good understanding of field theory. And they have developed, this is a field where most of the time in solid state physics and condensed matter, the experimenter discovers first and the theoretician struggle much later to come up with a theory of understanding. We saw this in the case of superconductivity itself, 1911 to 1957 before they understood. This is a field where the theoreticians have said this should exist, please look for it, and it came. Okay, today the field is very, very this thing. And again, there is nothing which is it's still a single body problem. It's not a many body problem. It's like a band structure. It is same whatever Bloch theorem and so on. But so far, people were looking only at the energy levels. If people start looking at the wave function and the way the wave functions are distributed, then you find there are some funny features which come. Okay? This again, where people, in spite of so many, then when somebody tells, oh, I should have looked at the distribution of wave function, and there is a twisted nature for something when I take the spin-orbit interaction, and that leads to some spectacular property. Right? So this is again moving away from the Landau's prescription. Landau's prescription of understanding is mostly in terms of energy levels. Okay? This, in the case of topological listing, it's about looking at the wave function and the way they are distributed, and that leads to very, very nice property of material. And this is today a very hot topic driven by, if somebody can say the electrons on the surface, maybe next slide. Next slide, I'm sure. So basically a topological insulator is a material whose bulk is a insulator, whose surface is a metal. Now this you will have to agree, it's a different state of matter, right? The bulk is an insulator and the surface is a metal. And the surface is a metal because of topology, okay? It's not from this thing. Or in other words, a picture, but after all, topology is something, a subject, you know, we see a Mobius strip is involved. There is no way by cutting and this thing you can make it into two separate rings, right? So if you say bulk, so these are insulators which are different from the insulators we know of. The insulator like argon crystal is an insulator, quartz is an insulator. They are similar to vacuum as an insulator. It's the best insulator, no doubt, no current can pass through it. They are all insulators of the type where the valence band and conduction band are in certain order. This is a material whose wave function, the wave function is like a knot, let's say. So if I have to connect an insulator of this type to a normal insulator like a vacuum, after all, any material is in contact with vacuum or an air, necessarily if it has to link, this ring has to be cut open before I can form this. Which means, if a material, a topological insulator is present, necessarily the surface will be metallic. So the metallicity of the surface is given by topology, not by other thing that you have doped the material and made it metallic and so on. So this is a very fantastic thing. It's new form of matter whose this thing comes from this thing. It is also that the dispersion of electrons are different. The dispersion is not the parabolic dispersion, it's a like Dirac dispersion. So you have, essentially you have this new material, which are called topological insulator, where the bulk is a metal, the surface which is shown in slightly golden color is a metal, and the electrons there are moving in a chiral fashion. That they are spin polarized electrons. The electrons of one direction are moving in one ring, the electrons of opposite spin are moving in opposite direction. So this is a fantastic state of matter, and people are interested in exploiting it to the fullest possible. Of course, you have to reduce the contribution of the bulk and stuff. So I started out my, at least gave the title of my talk as states of matter, traditional and exotic. If I were asked in what way something is, we try to see what is, how we define a state of matter. There is some unique property of the material. Or maybe next slide, next. Last, I will close to the last. I will not talk about all this. Last. Yeah, pass it, please. Actually, I do not know whether you have, maybe you should take a look. More is different. This is almost a cult paper by one of the very eminent scientists, P.W. Anderson, who describes about how, I mean, he wants to actually, this is a paper which is written in against the idea of reductionism, against the idea that every property of a material or the whole world can be understood by going into smaller and smaller scale. He's making a case that a new properties emerge at different length scale. Okay, so he's actually making a case that solid state physics or many body physics is different from elementary particle. Just because you know elementary particle physics, it doesn't mean you will get this thing. Just because you know chemistry, chemistry is not the same as many body physics, or molecular biology is not the same as chemistry, cell biology is not the same as molecular biology. As levels of organization change, there is a property which emerges. Okay, so we are in, when we are dealing with solid state physics system, we are still dealing with electrons and atoms. This is nothing new, but when they combine in variety of ways, they come have a new property, or a new property emerges. Okay, and then people worry about how did this come about. Okay, and much of the success in the early part was in the by the idea of Landau, of how an order parameter helps to define what is a new, how is it something called a magnet, how, because science, as I told you, developed by defining a language, otherwise we'll just be saying it's a magnet. So the formal language of understanding phase transition was in by Landau. The new type of material which we are talking about, both in the terms of high temperature superconductor or the topological insulator, they do not fit into this Landau paradigm. So if you say something is an exotic state of matter, sure, up to the BCS superconductivity can be explained within the Landau's framework. It was a difficult theory, but it still can be explained as if it is the dressed electrons which are moving around. But when you come to this topological states of matter, the electron loses its character as an electron. For example, in a fractional quantum Hall effect, the excitations are entities which have one third of a charge. There is no way you can have a particle. So you start with a system, you bring them together, a new entity comes up, and a new wave function develops, is described as if it has a charge of one third. So it's an entity which is a combination of an electron and a flux associated with it. So these are all very different things. So it's not, so this, in this case, the Landau's paradigm is about, I started with talking about the free electron. People were worried about how does the free electron work. They kept on dressing it. Okay, the electron is more or less free. It is only slightly heavy. It is not the same as the value of the mass of the free electron. But when you have the electron, the entity which is moving, changes charge from the charge of an electron to one third of a charge of electron, then you know this is not adiabatically possible. I mean, it is not by any continuous transition I will not get it. There is something new happening. Just like if the transition is involving topology, there is no way you can do it by gradual changes. It is either this way connected or that way connected, right? And these are the new forms of matter which are coming up. And we should also appreciate that if so much of progress has happened based on the slide of what we know as a metal insulator, semiconductor, and so on. All our IC chips work on that. Imagine what will come when you start exploiting these new forms of matter. Okay? And as I told you, lot of research goes on in using this topological states of matter for fault-resistant topological computation. Okay? And so on. So you are, as young students, you are all in exciting times, I'm telling you. And much of what I said is all more or less within the subject of solid-state physics. More or less what is covered in Kittel. So as young students, I will say, please read your Kittel properly and then proceed further. Okay? Thanks a lot. Bye.
The floor is now open for the discussions.
Sir, I heard about quantum vortices in superfluid helium 2.
Yeah.
How does the whole concept of quantum vortex explain rolling film?
Okay. The void is, see, you know, in the case of superfluid helium, it is like it has many. There is one thing called the film will rise along the surface of Earth. The part on the quantum vortices is it's just like if you set liquid into motion, there are discrete units into which the motion. I do not know how it will explain the creep experiment that I have. I'm not here, but the quantum vortices is the same as the vortex of a superconductor. So there is, when you say it's a quantum vortex, the normal region is the, if you say a superfluid helium is made up of a normal fluid and a superfluid helium, or a liquid helium is consists of that, then the normal region is the center of the vortex core, and the helium, the superfluid helium flows around, and that motion is quantized, just like in the case of a superconductor. The flux, where the flux, magnetic flux goes through, that is the normal region of the metal, and the superconducting electrons flow up. Okay, that there is a 1:1 analogy between the two. But how, what property it explains, I am not sure. People do use several systems as a, like ion traps are used, or people will use NMR type of experiment, and so on. I think among all of them, the ion traps is the one which has made a lot more progress. And in all this, one of the issue is about what they say is about the decoherence. So, I think in that context, when these people talk about this topologically reflected quantum computation, maybe the problem of decoherence will be slightly offset in this matter. That's why they are. I do not know how much it will finally reach.
Thank you, sir. I now call upon Professor P. Subhashini to deliver the word of thanks.
Good afternoon. I'm here to transform our sense of gratitude into words. First and foremost, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the chief guest, Dr. C.S. Sundar, for accepting our invitation and to come here out of his very, very busy schedule. Sir, we feel really proud. Now it's in our record that such an eminent personality has been here with us today. Sir, thank you so much for your enlightening, informative, and interesting lecture on states of matter, traditional to exotic. Sir, for the past 1 hour, I think we remained paramagnetic to your lecture. I take this opportunity to record my thanks to the person who is the backbone of the Physics Alumni Society, a person of inspiration and admiration to all of us, a great professor of the Department of Physics, who is none other than Dr. N. Lakshmi Narayan, who is the president of Physics as an Alumni Society. Thank you, sir. I thank wholeheartedly all our retired faculty members, Professor B.M. Arthur, Dr. G. Kumasatyam, Dr. J.F. Rajshekaran, who have been here, and also Dr. Ennellan, sir, who have been here giving their valuable time today. It's also time to thank all the office bearers of Physics Alumni Society for their efforts in this regard. I profusely thank the donors of the Professor K.M. Karunakaran Endowment Fund for their generosity, and without them, this privilege we won't be having today. It gives me immense pleasure to thank our beloved HOD, Dr. P. Samuel Asirvadam, for his tireless efforts in coordinating with everyone and organizing this lecture today on behalf of the department. I thank Dr. Manju and Professor Vijayashri from Meenakshi College for Women for coming over here. And I thank all the students from other institutions for participating in this lecture today. My thanks are due to our principal for providing this venue. I thank all the faculty of the department for their cooperation in conducting this event, especially Professor Daniel for the AV arrangements and the PPT, Professor Janet for the MC, and Dr. Joyce for the hall arrangements, CMM and DSK for the prayer. I wish to record my thanks to Mr. Sindhu, Center for Media Studies, for the photography and videography, and all the non-teaching staffs of the department for their help. Last, but never the least, I thank my student friends from our department and chemistry for their presence and participation. I thank you, one and all present here.